I am Shusara Kona Kumara. Welcome to Satsang. You are beginningless. You are endless. You are divine. Good evening, everybody. This is Shusara Kona Kumara. You're listening to Satsang with the Shambhala Center. Thank you so much for welcoming us into your space tonight. We're thrilled to be here. We're going to go ahead and get started. So I'm going to have you take a nice deep breath and get yourself centered, and let's clear the space. Mother, Father, God, that I am, through the great central sun hierarchy, through the office of the Christ, through the order of Melchizedek, I call upon Archangel Michael to bring the sapphire blue ray. Cut away, cut away, cut away anything in all of our four lower vehicles not emanating directly from our I am presence. I now call on Archangel Zachiel, keeper of the violet flame. Blaze, blaze, blaze the violet flame through all of our four lower bodies. Transmute, transmute, transmute all the psychic debris Michael has cut free. I now bring forth the invincible ring pass knot and the mirror blue light of invisibility to completely surround each of us. And I call forth a shaft of pure Christ light, one shaft to surround each one of us, and I ask that they be brought to the center of the earth, where I call on Archangel Gabriel to seal them, and I ask that the legions of Michael completely surround each tube of light. And now I ask that our vibrations be raised high above the psychic and astral worlds to the highest realm of illumined truth we each can attain at this time. And now, Mother, Father, God, we place ourselves in service to you, to humanity, and I place myself in service to all of you tonight. We ask that only that which is direct from you be permitted into our perceptions, and that all else of the lower mind be kept out. And we ask that only that which is direct from you be permitted through us. Because we have asked this, we consider it so. So be it. Good. Come on back to me. All right. I hope you're all having a good week, enjoying your Thursday night. And again, thank you for joining us. I wanted to say, too, that for those of you who haven't heard me talk about the protection that I do at the beginning of the program, if you go to our BBS page, you will see that protection there. All listed out, and it actually, I think, don't we have a picture up of the I am, you know, the monad down into the physical form, so you can actually see a visual representation of a lot of what the protection is kind of all about. And another thing that we do have on our YouTube channel, which is, I think, just Shambhala Center, isn't it? Or is it the Shambhala Center? I forget.
I'll look it up really quick.
Okay. But on our YouTube channel, we have the protection, me actually speaking the protection. So, and I overlaid it with the actual words so you can read it at the same time too. So if you want to have that for any reason for yourself, then feel free to do that. We may even have it through our website. I know we were going to put it on there. So I don't know, things are in flux. I can't keep up. Okay, I want to talk about what I want to talk about tonight. We're definitely going to be talking about attachment tonight because it came up in Satsang here in Charlotte before the radio program, and there's been a lot of movement among our some of my advanced students this week. So it was a good time to kind of look at that again. So let's open the phone up to callers if you want to call in and ask me questions about the work that we do here. Feel free if you want to especially ask questions tonight about attachment, beliefs, desires, attachments, things like that. This would be a good time for those questions, and I'd be happy to field those. Yeah. Okay. So, PielleAyan, I'm going to have to call on you here because she was a large part of our previous session. She's been moving through some stuff. Now, when we do this, when we actually call on people and we talk, we usually keep things kind of vague because it actually doesn't serve another person to hear a third party's like personal experiences, because too much gets planted in the mind to be used later as needed. So we try to keep things kind of vague. So PielleAyan, I'm going to ask you to share, you know how to share with people this way that we do. So I'm going to ask you to share kind of your experience this week and then what it brought up for you. Because I think this is so, it's so important to, especially for people who are listening and, you know, who don't have the opportunity to be kind of with me to go through the teachings, you know, one-on-one and all that kind of stuff. And the other reason is you mentioned, I think it was, we have a newsletter that we put out every month, and our submissions are due this week for the newsletter. And I know PielleAyan is struggling because she's been in it, you know, she's like been in seriously deep process for the last few days. And this is good because it's challenging again, your whole concept of what do I have to offer? You know, what can I share that's kind of, you're viewing it in one way that it's supposed to be something that's going to be uplifting or to show them a revelation or whatever. And, you know, I think that's just purely conceptual. Can it not just be, wow, am I in it? And look what I'm looking at right now. And I didn't realize there was still so much stuff that's so, you know, it's so entrenched that I'm down in it again. Right. And there's value in that. And it's a beautiful thing for people. You know, here we are on an internet radio station, and I've got people who can listen from anywhere in the world. And, you know, you never know what words are going to come through you that are going to touch somebody. So you have to drop any concept that whatever it is that is being shared, you know, here or in a newsletter or anything, has to be a certain, you know, has to be a certain caliber of message. Like, what is that? You know, because you just don't know. And maybe in sharing the whole thing that you're going through, it'll be something that's going to wake another person up, and they're going to see where they've been stuck in the same thing. And maybe that's the only way they ever would have seen it, is to see someone else's revelation of, wow, I was stuck in this particular vantage point. My perception was locked here, and it took this experience for me to kind of wake up out of that, you know. And that's a very valuable thing to share. So why don't you go ahead and tell our listeners what's going on with you.
Okay. Well, first I want to give the YouTube channel. So that's youtube.com/user/Shambhala Center.
So if they just searched Shambhala Center, Shambhala, then they'd find our channel, right?
I believe so.
Okay. So either way. Okay. Thank you.
Of course, I have you as a subscription. So,
yes, and you can subscribe to that too.
Nice. So I plug. Found you very easily.
You're funny. All right.
Okay, so this week, oh God.
Yes.
So this week, it actually all started with, it's funny how things fall into place, but lately, now you find that, you know, I feel like as you advance in these teachings and this work, people kind of automatically flock to you for advice and things like that. And so recently I've had a lot of people tell me that either they see me as their guide or I should be a teacher. And that actually started kind of really getting in there, like, well, maybe I should. And I kind of felt like that was the direction that I was moving, that my, what I was thinking was my level of service was shifting. And so I also had it locked in my head that Shusara had, when she decided that this was what she was going to do, that she asked her guide, Atona, basically for her blessing to move forward with this. I was wrong about that. So, Tuesday, I decided I was going to ask her. And then she shot me down. and just really was like, no, you're not ready. And then I had to deal with the whole thing about not being ready and what my idea of being in service was, and how I was just so really kind of tripped up in that, and realizing that, you know, getting that feedback from people made me feel good. And then I just started looking at all things that I felt like I was in service for. But so Tuesday and Wednesday, I was just, God, I was so very low those 2 days, just swimming in it. And I couldn't even really begin to process because I was just, my ego was so hurt. Uh-huh. By it, especially because you start to realize what love and trust is in this reality, you know, and being that for so very long you were like the only person that I trusted, like fully trusted, and the only person that I believed really truly loved me unconditionally. And then when that came, I was like, what? Like, I had such a hard time dealing with it. So yeah, I was swimming in it for Tuesday and Wednesday. And then this morning, I finally was able to start to process things out and see things coming up and things that were hidden and, that I was able to cover up by being of service. And that was like my excuse to keep doing it. And it's an easy one to hide because mm-hmm. you think you're doing a good thing. Like, oh, I'm helping these people, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yes, it's a very benevolent one.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's the perfect justifier.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm of service.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
And then the other thing that really caught me up was because, you know, you had reminded me that you had taken a break for a year from teaching because of your attachment to it. So then that threw me into process too, well, down the rabbit hole, because I really truly was like, oh my God, she's going to ban me from satsang and seeing her and doing everything. And what if it takes a year?
Oh, that's it's priceless. It's just priceless. I mean, look at just the projection, and that's what the mind does. It projects, right? That's all. I mean, that's really all it's capable of doing, is just projecting out. And of course, it's going to project out the worst case scenario for most people. Very, very normal. And then because of the projection and then the belief in it, you just spiral deeper and deeper and deeper. Now, I'll just ask you so you can tell the audience, you know, was it true? Like, just from the vantage point of my love for you, unconditional love for you, and my trustworthiness, was that really called into question? Even though you experienced that it was, yeah.
actually, even though it was actually very strange this time going through it, because since it was you, it was funny because I was actually able to still, as much as it was all running and I was in it and I wanted to say screw you, I still knew that you loved me. I still knew that I could trust you.
Mm-hmm. Excellent. That is a really big thing. A really big thing. In the beginning, when someone's working with a guide, you know, that's one of the first things that I will sit down and tell them. Like, you have to trust me 100%. Like 100%. Linda's looking at me and shaking her head like, yes, I remember. Because I tell everybody, there will be times, I promise you, you know, if I'm doing my job well, there will be times where you're going to doubt me. And you have to trust me. And so when those times come, when you doubt me, when you're angry, when you feel like I, you know, I don't have your best interest at heart or something, you have to bring it to me because it has to get cleared. If it doesn't get cleared, it's going to turn into this thing that will destroy, you know, the bond that we will create. And that's very serious. Like, I mean that. I absolutely mean that. And so this point that PielleAyan is speaking about is really key. Because in the beginning, you swim so much in the story, the personal stories that come, that you lose complete sight of who that guide is and the fact that they've already walked it. They know what they're doing. You know, they're not going to bring you someplace that you aren't supposed to be, or that it isn't time for you to go, or anything like that. And then it's because it's just so personal. You know, you just kind of can't see it. But then there reaches a point where that bond is so strong and the amount of work you've done is enough that even when you're spiraling, you never lose that part that goes, wait a minute. Okay, for as lost as I feel right now, like, she wouldn't do that to me if there wasn't a reason. She just wouldn't. And that's really key. That's really key. Because it shows that you're at a level where that level of trust is so strong that it's overriding, you know, the personal self's desire to be right, you know, its desire to hold its story at all costs. And it's just a different level that you function from at that point, you know. And so that's beautiful. I'm glad that you brought that up, because a lot of people don't recognize it when it comes. But like you said, it was different this time. You know, and in the past, you probably would forget until you processed it out or had help processing it out. And then you were like, oh, oh, you never really let me down, or you never really whatever, you know. And now it stays there. And that's beautiful. And it will stay there, you know. I had moments myself in that kind of a thing where the mind wanted to look at my guide and be like, she doesn't know what the heck. She doesn't know me. You know? Whatever the story is, what does she know, right? And there comes a point where that just doesn't matter what the story is, you know. At some point, it's like you see the guide as God, yeah? Because the guide becomes like the only thing you're capable of actually seeing is God in this crazy world. You have moments where you see everything as God. You have moments where you see yourself as God, right? But it seems like, for a time, the guide is the one representation that you really, truly do have. And the faith that you have in that person is the one thing that it literally will lead you through. And I've told the story like a bazillion times about when I was having my own experience of like sitting under the Bodhi tree, right? And all of this stuff was coming at me. And it was all stuff like we talked about last week about concept and all the concepts, and that if we are looking for proof of any concept in the world, it's very easy to find, right? Because all of it is here. And, you know, having that experience where all of these concepts are running and I see, you know, quote unquote, hard proof in the world of the things that I'm believing to be true, but yet knowing that I'm in it and my guide was the one who put me in it, the way I saw it, there was something in that that was like that guide was the only thing that I could come back to. And I literally had that mental process. I went through that was, but it's her. She's the one I need to keep focused on. Not all of this other stuff that's running. Her. What did she tell me? Focus on that, right? And just hold that point of focus. And literally when I went through that experience, that was how I saw her. That's God right there. Keep your focus right there and don't let it stray. No matter what's going on, don't let it stray. And that was how I moved through that process. And it was so illuminating, you know, to actually go through it like that and to see it from that place. And that was like one of the hardest ones that I've ever walked through because in the physical world, it made no sense. You know, in the physical world, everything was telling me that what she was saying was not accurate, you know, as if she was going to like blatantly lie to me or something. Like, and literally that's what was coming up. Oh, she's lying. Like she literally just made that up, right? Or whatever. And whatever. I probably had, you know, 20 or 30 things that came that I wanted to point my finger at her about. And, you know, this is all your fault and this is all blah. You know, the details don't matter. It could be any story. It could be anything. All right. Now on the other side of it, I mean, it was just hysterical when I woke up from it. Literally, because that's kind of what you do. You wake up like, oh my God, like, wow. I actually thought all that was real. You know, and where was it real? It was only real in, you know, for lack of a better term, like in my head. Right? It's the only place that it was real. And you get completely lost in it, you know. So that's what you've been moving through, that whole thing of being locked into a concept. And then we get very comfortable in it, right? And especially when they're benevolent. Being a light worker is a very, very benevolent concept. Being of service, you know, benevolent. But it's a trap too, right? As I was just saying earlier to the people here, that if you're... Think of it this way. I like to be very logical, and a lot of people appreciate that because so many, you know, spiritual things seem so kind of lofty. They're hard to get your head around. And the point is that, you know, you should be able to get your head around these things and then have the actual experience of them later. So my point was, we were talking about attachment and everything. And I was saying that, you know, on one side you have attachment and on the other side you have resistance. And it's very difficult for someone to go in looking for where they're attached because it hides very well. Now, certain things are pretty obvious, right? I know I'm attached to my spouse, for example. Like, I really love my spouse. And if my spouse came home and said, I want a divorce, it would be very difficult and I wouldn't understand and I'd fight and I'd want to, you know, work it out, whatever. Okay. So, okay, I can see that I'm attached. Maybe I could see I'm attached to my favorite sports team, right? Some people can see that pretty easily. I'm attached to my house or my job or my dog, you know. Other things are very hard to see, especially when they're not, you know, when they're more conceptual than they are an actual physical thing. And what PielleAyan was seeing is the attachment to even the concept of being in service doesn't function for your highest good, right? It doesn't stop you from being of service, certainly, but it'll stop you in progressing in your dissolution work. Okay. And what I was saying is that, to come back again, that if you're running towards something, right, because you desire it, meaning there's an attachment there and you desire it. Well, in order for you to be running towards something, it means you're running away from something else, right? So on a continuum, you can see that. If you're running towards something, you're also simultaneously running away from something. And that's what everybody's doing. So because it can be difficult to see an attachment to something that's more subtle, what I tell people to look for is look for your resistance, because resistance is usually pretty easy to find. Now, even resistance gets very subtle. Why are you shaking your head? Come here. Linda's funny. Let's see what she has to say here.
I can see attachment way better than I can see resistance. I tend to be able to see where I attach much easier than I see resistance, because I just did not want to see resistance, period. I would not admit that I was in resistance to anything.
Why?
Because it was a negative.
And what did that mean?
That it was bad.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, I didn't want to do the bad stuff. And so, yeah, I blocked that part out, but I could very obviously see, oh, I see I'm attached to that, and I see I'm attached to that. So finding the attachments for me personally was easier than seeing the resistance. Now here lately, I've shifted in that, and I can now see resistance and I see attachment both. But I had a question. As I was sitting there shaking my head, I had someone ask me earlier this week. Actually, I think it was, it was like Monday night. I was talking to someone, and we were talking. They actually brought up the fact that something about attachment and how I got to look at that, don't I? I've got to look at that and not be attached to the outcome. And I said, well, yes, that's true. And then I kind of lost my train of thought just now.
And isn't that the way it is? It's a beautiful moment, isn't it? When you're sitting there and you go completely blank and you know people are listening to you all over the place. Yeah. Okay. So when you pick it up again, you let me know. But yes, it is true that if there is attachment that's recognized, the outcome, you know, that's what we are attached to, is the outcome. And it does have to be dropped. It does have to be dropped, because it is a prison cell when you're attached to the outcome. Do you have anything else you want to say? No, she's good. It's not always easy being in the hot seat over here, Linda. And then when people always ask me, what did you just say? And I have no idea, because there's nothing running mentally when I'm speaking. So it's just gone. Okay. So as we continue to talk about attachment, now I'm trying to figure out where we're going to go from here. It's one of those situations where you have to look at all of it. Now, I say resistance is easy for a lot of people, but like you were saying, it isn't necessarily. If you happen to be one of those people who was really raised, like, very strongly that the grass is always greener, you know, the whole, like, looking through life with rose-colored glasses, like, and from a good place, like, that's what the expectation was. It's funny, I just had a session with someone yesterday about exactly that. So her thing is she was absolutely raised that, you know, she needed to be a big girl. Right. Meaning you can't let yourself collapse. You can't let yourself fall apart, because if you do, who knows what's going to happen? Like, you know, all hell will break loose if you allow yourself to fall apart. And even bringing in, you know, you don't know how it'll affect other people. Right. And so the point there was I had to get her to go in and see where that concept of that person that we named, you know, the big girl, where it was coming from, right? It was coming out of, you know, her need to continue to have this savior in place that we called the big girl was coming out of the fear of being in shame, right? So the thing that she couldn't see is that in being, you know, it didn't matter that no one ever specifically said to her, if you fall apart, you know, everything's going to collapse. It didn't matter. The fact was she was told, you know, now you need to be strong, right? Now we need to just keep a good attitude. Because as soon as you're told that, remember, language is polarized. So you can't say one thing without inferring the opposite equally, right? You see that? I can't say me without somewhere in there it registering you or you know, not me, whatever that is. So, and it was the same for her. And that's what I had to get her to see. You know, I didn't tell her, but I got her to see it. She walked into it and was able to see, oh my God, like I feel like every time something comes and I start to experience some kind of resistance, yeah, which is indicative of a level of pain, the big girl comes in to, you know, act as kind of the savior, to swing me out of what I'm sitting in. Why? And that was the part, like, she couldn't see it. She could not see it. It hides so well, she couldn't see it. It took us at least a half an hour to get her to actually see shame, and I had to really walk her to it before she could even pull that word out, because it hides so well, right? So if the big girl doesn't come in, it means that what? Well, if the big girl doesn't come in, then something goes wrong, and who's to blame for that? I will be, right? If I you know, lose my cool and something bad happens, it's my fault, right? And if it's my fault, then what? Well, do you see? There's shame that sits there. It's my fault. How do you experience it being my fault without simultaneously experiencing shame? Because you would feel ashamed of yourself. Yeah. Guilty for doing it, ashamed of yourself. Right? And that's the piece that everyone's running away from. Right? So we'll just scramble to do whatever we have to do to create this peace that will pull us out of that experience so that we don't have to experience the thing that is actually sitting there anyway, and we just continue to run from, right? Because it's embedded in it. It's embedded in it. I hope you can see that from wherever you're sitting as you're listening. Because it's important. This is a really important piece. The resistance comes it can come in very subtle ways, right? So I tell people, you know, to pay attention to the body, because the body will always tell you. Eckhart Tolle is really good for that, right? Brings people's attention to the, what does he call it? I don't even know what he calls it. The pain body? Is that what you said? Okay, so the pain body. So he brings you to that space, you know, it's very energetic and physical even. And you could feel it. Well, of course, because the body has to reflect the state of consciousness that is running through it, right? So when there's resistance internally, it has to come through as some sort of energetic in the body. And so I tell people to pay attention to the little signals you get from the actual physical form that tells you you're in resistance. Yeah. And for a lot of people, like, you're so, and this is the thing, you're so habituated to how you internalize things and take things and whatever it is that you physically do, that you don't even see it. You know, you'll see it in another person really easily, but you won't see it in yourself, you know. So if you, you know, you're a mother and a child walks in the room, and that's all it takes, right? The child walks in the room. And the story is, you know, mom never gets any time alone, and she just wants peace and quiet. She just wants to be alone. So the child walks in and mom goes, and that's it, right? There's resistance. It's right there. How do you miss that? Well, it's very easy to miss that. Right. And then what happens? Then the child picks up on it because energetically they feel it and they go, what's wrong, mom? And then what does mom say?
I have to.
You're a mess. What does mom say?
They say nothing.
Nothing. That's right. Why? Well, there's like a plethora of reasons that mom's going to come up with why she would say nothing, right? But part of it is she's trying to convince herself that it's nothing. And it's like, no, the sigh came because the belief is, you know, my story's true. It's true. They're all out to get me. No one ever wants me ever to have peace and quiet. They have no concept of how hard I work. If they could only see what I go through. Look at Linda. You're waving your flag. Your violin, yeah. That's right. Yes, mom's pity party. All in a sigh, right, that is barely discernible to others, much less her. So the resistance is there. I promise you it's there. You just have to start paying attention. You have to be open to seeing it, you know. And that's one of the biggest hurdles is people come to this work saying they want liberation, you know. But the proof's in the pudding, isn't it? You don't really know you want liberation until you start coming up against this stuff. And how bad do you want it? Because you're going to have to look at all these things. You know, let's remember, you know, the vast majority of people are convinced that they're right about everything. They're convinced that they're humble. They're convinced that they're honest. They're convinced that they're what? Altruistic and considerate and loving and kind and what else, you know? Christ incarnate. Right? Everyone's convinced of that, almost. Yeah? Because we're kind of raised to embrace the things where we think we're doing well and to be in denial over the things that we're not doing well because we have to, you know, blame someone else. It's your fault that I wasn't capable of doing that, or, you know, it's your fault for not teaching me. I didn't know any better. Whatever the story is, there are a million of them. And it takes a lot of guts to go in and to start seeing it for what it is, you know. Because anything that you want to hold as being true for you, I promise, is true on the other side as well. You just aren't seeing it yet. I don't lie. That's a good one. Lying's bad, you know. Oh my gosh. Don't ever lie. I wouldn't lie. I promise you, you lie some way, somehow. You're probably just lying to yourself. And even that's it. You're still lying. Yeah. You're still lying. You know, and that's the funny part. And you know, I laugh, and I've probably offended more people when they work with me for just laughing at them. Because to me, it's just hysterical. And of course, everyone, when you're sitting in that place and you take everything so personally, you're like, why is she laughing at me? But it's so funny, you know, because everyone, you are both sides, and we're just walking through this space of, you know, but I'm this. And, you know, it's partially my privilege and honor to show you where you're not that, you know, which is what I had to do with you. Yeah. And I've had to do with all of my students. It's not personal, you know. I mean, the funny thing is, there's nothing personal anyway. I mean, even the students who think that they have a personal relationship with their guide, from that level, it's not personal, because who's the student? The student's the ego. There's nothing personal there. There isn't, you know. Why is that funny, PielleAyan?
Because I think that's a concept that a lot of us really like, especially like the ones of us that kind of go hard with this, you know, like we're the student, and you know, I to think that we're not, we're just the ego. That's really funny.
That's right. That's right. That's right. Yeah. You know, and it is true. From the space of the guide, sometimes you're in session with someone and it's all you can do to just keep from busting out laughing. You know? But you don't, because, you know, for that moment, it's not appropriate. Yeah. But that's what's going on. It's a dialogue between, you know, the ego and the one who sees through it. And that's all that's really going on, you know. So people get really attached to their gurus and teachers and, you know, think they have this, I have this amazing relationship. And this is a beautiful thing with, oh my God, this is a beautiful thing with like people who, you know, have a spiritual teacher and stuff. Like, you know, if you went to say, you know, Sai Baba's ashram when he was in physical form, I mean, people would be, you know, pushing ahead of each other in line. They're lining up early so they can get a good seat and all that. It's all about being close to close to Baba, you know? And it's ridiculous. The whole thing's ridiculous. Oh, he looked at me. So I, you know, must mean he, that means something. And of course, that's what the mind is going to do. It's going to look for anything it can to give me a reason to feel good about myself. Right. And then what's that basically we talked about tonight? Everyone's just looking for something to feel good about. And we get attached to the things that make us feel good, right? Whether they're true or not, we're attached to them. And when then it's, once you get attached, then you're just addicted to it. And in that state, you can't see the other side, you know, and you refuse to see the other side, much less be identified with the other side. But it is true, you know, and what I did tonight in session was very challenging for one of our people. It was her first night in, and ooh, she picked a hardcore night to come in. Did she not? Yeah, she probably will never come back again, I'm guessing, after tonight. Because I had to talk about, we were talking about attachment, and that's what came to talk about tonight, so I did. And I called into question, I mean, your attachment to your children. I was talking about a certain yogi who used to have his students who wanted to work with him. They were desirous of enlightenment. He used to have these people literally leave their lives, and he would tell them where to go, and they were there to assume a new name and get a job and a place to live. And every 6 months he would move them, and they'd have to take on another identity and do it all over again. And the point was that you can't get too attached, can you, if you're constantly moving and you're always a different person and you always have a different job, and there's, what are you attached to? And it keeps consciousness moving, you know. And a lot of, it's funny, I just heard another teacher, I happened to be listening to a program that just aired, and that was one thing that she said. It's funny that it came up here too, that, you know, a lot of highly advanced people, souls, whatever you want to call it, do that. They just move constantly because there's no attachment, you know, and then no way to become attached. And that goes back to that John Rogers story I told tonight too, where he hadn't, someone, one of his followers was telling a story of him, and he hadn't danced in 20 years, and she danced with him, and he was actually nervous. And after, she said, "But you're such a good dancer, you know, don't you like to dance?" And he said, "I love to dance." And she says, "Well, why don't you dance more often?" And he said, "Because I love it too much, you know." And he hadn't danced in 20 years because he loved it so much, right? It's very easy to become attached to the things that we love deeply. And he knew that for him to do his work, it meant there could not be an attachment. So the easiest thing to do was just not to dance rather than to constantly fight the battle. Yeah. See? So attachments like that. And for this particular person who came in tonight, you know, conceptually, oh my gosh, she didn't know what to do with that, because the concept of why would you leave your children and your family when it would cause so much pain for the children and trauma, and, you know, and what I didn't have a chance to say to her, and probably it was good, because I don't know that she could have, where she was functioning from, and she could have kind of handled it, was that, you know, the inner world and the outer world are the same thing, and you're the only one in it. So there are no children that you're hurting. There's no husband that's getting wounded. It's all you. It's all you. Right? Just the one. And even outside of that, which is a very deep and profound understanding. Okay. So that's hard to get yourself around. So if we take it down to another level, even from another level, you can't ever hurt anybody, right? Your essence is beginningless, endless, formless, single, being, knowledge, bliss. That can't be hurt, can it? It can't be. It's impossible. The essence of you cannot be touched. Now remember, the essence of you resides where it always has been, you know, in the heart of God. That's who you are. This reality that you're experiencing, or I believe to be experiencing, is a projection of consciousness that is warped, right? But it's just a projection. So for as real as it may seem, no one here is actually getting hurt. I don't care what's going on. There's no one here getting hurt. It looks that way in the realm of time and space and densification and polarization. But that world is not real, right? That world is not real. This world is always changing. Everything comes into form and it goes out of form and it's constantly moving. That's not eternal. That's limitation. Everything here is constriction. You are expansion. And I mean the you outside of this reality. You are expansion, eternal expansion that never had a beginning. But this reality and your concept of who you are in this reality is all about constriction and contraction, right? So this world, as we spoke about last week, I mean, this world is the exact like shadow or negative to what is real. So kind of like looking at a negative of a photograph where everything is backwards. You know, everything that's light is dark and everything that's dark is light. That's what this is. Right. So, you know, the ego or the personal self becomes attached to the things that make it feel good. And one of the hardest things to do is to search out those things that make you feel good and start to challenge those and then do what you need to do to stop the identification with it. It doesn't mean you have to stop doing whatever it is, right? It's just the attachment to it. See, the point is that if you do something and you're a different person when you do that than you are when you do something else, something's going on, you see? Because the true you should be you regardless of whatever's going on. But if you find that, you know, and this is a good one for people who are quote unquote spiritual, they'll sit in meditation and they will stop everything to get into meditation. Why? Because it feels good. They like to be in that space. And a lot of people get completely trapped in that space. They reach higher levels of meditation and it's so seductive because it feels so good that they move into a space where they have a preference for being in that state, right? They're like, oh God, I can't wait to go into meditation again. I feel like crap. I want to go into meditation. Meditation becomes the savior, you know. But you're here to actually exist in a space where there's no preference, right? It doesn't have to move you anyway. It doesn't matter what's going on because you are, the essence of you is the essence of you, and that's unchangeable, see? And that's the Christ in form. Unchangeable. Yeah. But it doesn't make it easy when the identified self is still the one running the show. And from that place, it can feel, you know, life can feel very challenging and frustrating. And from one level, from that level, you know, it's there's nothing wrong with calling on assistance. There's nothing wrong with doing your protections and calling on the archangels and the ascended masters to help. And, you know, I mean, there's nothing wrong with that, see. Just because that level of reality is not the highest truth does not mean that when you're in it, that's not appropriate. Because it is appropriate. Because you're in it until you're not. Right? And you can only take one step at a time. You don't go from being a completely identified person who is utterly unconscious in the world to functioning from non-polarized state of consciousness. It doesn't happen like that. Right? There are steps that, you know, you have to kind of move, take your path as it comes, you know. So for now, start looking at these things, you know. Yes, there is serious issues in the world, like very serious. And we're not here to run away from them and we're not here to pretend that none of them exist. We have to look. We have to look at all of it, right? And allow it to impact you. Allow it to make you angry. Allow it to make you sad. Just, you know. As Mother Teresa's quote, you know, God, break my heart so completely that the whole world falls in. That's beautiful. Allow yourself to be heartbroken, right? There's nothing wrong with that. Because this reality, you should be. I mean, let's look at what's going on. Don't be in denial about what's actually happening, right? Keep striving to move ever higher, you know, to get to move through all of it. That's the point. That's the point. You'll come into the understandings as they are appropriate for you. The work is experiential. You can't learn your way to it. You've got to walk your way through it. It's experiential. So the reason I chose tonight's meditation song, which does not seem like a meditation song, is in direct relation to what I'm just saying. You know, this song tonight is meant to just like, it's okay. Be in the world, right? Be in the world and call on help when you need help. There's nothing wrong with that. It's a sign of humility. It's a beautiful thing. Do what you need to do. All things will come in their own time. And you just show up and you keep walking the walk. All right. I send you all my love and blessings, and I hope that you'll be with us again next Thursday. Have a great meditation. We love you. Good night.
I need a sign to let me know you're here. All of these lines are being crossed over the atmosphere. Call it.
You are divine.